Very good afternoon to everybody. My name is Shashank Sharma, and on behalf of SCOMI Solutions Private Limited, I would like to welcome you all to today's webinar on private equity and venture capital investments. How will the sector evolve post-COVID-19? We've been conducting a series of webinars on this note, and a very warm welcome to everybody who has joined in today, the fresh joinees as well as the continued attendees who have been attending us. This topic was very much in the need of the hour, and we thought that this is the best time to address this, once we are about towards the second phase of the lockdown. And I think to address this topic with us here today, we have a very dynamic panel which comprises of, different, what I would say, sectors and different market sizes from the Indian economy. To introduce the panel to you, first of all, on behalf of Mr. Ritesh Chandra. Mr. Ritesh Chandra is the managing partner with Aventus DE Investments. To introduce him, that he's having more than 22 years of deal making experience, and he has been working with Aventus for the last 10 years. And prior to working with Aventus, he has worked with companies like Credit Suisse and others. Thank you, Mr. Ritesh, for joining us today on this webinar. We have with us Ms. Richa Natarajan. She is the director at Unitas Capital. Richa is having 13 years of experience in the investment banking space, where she has worked with firms like Unitas, Deloitte, Ernst & Young. At Unitas, she is basically taking care on the SME and the mid-sized lending part. She has been involved in various deal-making processes with the group from that note. We have Mr. Ankur Bansal. He is the co-founder and director of Maxwell Capital, which is again a venture debt firm. Over there, Mr. Bansal is looking at different aspects of the deal execution. And prior to working with Maxwell, he has worked with different investment banks like JP Morgan, Citi, and Morgan Stanley as well. Well, so I think to introduce the panel further, so I think start with the topic itself. A check that we have already seen a lot of disruption being impacted due to this COVID-19 scenarios, and the economy towards itself is moving towards a slowdown, and we've seen certain I would say publications on the slowdown in the PE and the VC space as well. So just to take up a first question on this webinar, I'd like to put this up to you, Mr. Ritesh, that how do you think that the sector where you been working on has been impacted, and what is the current stage of that sector today, sir?
Good afternoon, everybody. So thanks, Shashank, for this. Look, the first and foremost, I think, the initial thought is that, listen, we haven't seen the last of this problem yet. So the bigger recognition that everybody in the market seems to have is the fact that we don't know how long this problem is going to be prolonged. And to that end, how deep is going to be the problem? I think we're focused on clearly, you said that we are looking at a slowdown. I think we're clearly looking at a recessionary, we're clearly looking at a clear-cut recession in the market. I think the kinds of which, unfortunately, India hasn't seen in the past before. So we have to be very well prepared for that as a country. Our sense is that first quarter GDP growth will be about -4%, and assuming things do open up on the 3rd of May, and thereafter we are going to likely to see another second quarter of also negative growth, but slightly lower. It's only towards the 3rd to the 4th quarter that things are likely to get likely to stabilize. Again, don't know the extent of the problem, don't know how big or how many waves of this is going to happen, but clearly, we're looking down a very, very bleak scenario as things stand today.
That's correct, sir. Absolutely. Thank you. Well, Richa, taking this on to you, since you've been working in the SME space and the mid-size space, so we do believe that this particular sector has been impacted the most, as everybody's saying. So, could you please share your thoughts on how do you think that this particular sector is going to be impacted, and what is the present state of this sector?
Sure. On the SME side, as you've rightly seen in the press, and a lot of it has been talked about how they've been impacted and significantly, in many significant ways, in both a crunch of capital as well as closure of many businesses resulting in issues, right? And SMEs are the backbone of our country. So having SMEs impacted significantly impacts the GDP numbers that Pritesh was rightly mentioning. In terms of both SME lending as well, there's been a significant crunch there. As you know, most of the NBFCs today are struggling in the market from not having liquidity at their own end and also trying to figure out on moratoriums that they need to give out to their end customer and the end clients. So while doing right by the customer, they're also squeezed in between of not having enough liquidity. So it's been a double whammy in some ways to the lending institutions, at least for now. The ones that are surviving are the ones that that are agile and are changing strategies very quickly and adapting to this environment. But the SME sector in general is under a lot of pressure and will continue to be. One has to see whether lockdown opens in March, in the month of May, and when it does, and in what types and phases does it open? Because even with the easing that has happened in terms of certain segments and essential services being, the definition itself being extended, the impact on the ground hasn't been as much from our understanding. So one has to see how the lockdown ultimately opens. And I think it's a tough decision in what's the phasing of the lockdown itself.
Correct. So I think we'll definitely deliberate on this topic further, you know, during the course of the webinar with respect to specifically the SMEs and the mid-sized companies. Well, taking the question to Mr. Ankur, sir, how do you think that, you know, since you've come from a venture debt space, you've been working very closely with all the startups in the past. So how do you think that the sector has impacted them, and what is the current scenario which they are facing today?
So I think nobody was ever ready for such a black swan kind of event. Everybody plans, obviously, now goes for a toss because nobody plans for this kind of a scenario. But whatever said and done, we have been in this situation for more than a month. And the good thing about startups is they are supposed to be nimble. So they should be able to, you know, really change the business plans, change their strategy very quickly. And that's what we have seen in our own portfolio companies and other companies that we have been tracking, that the decision making is very, very quickly, right? Whether it is as simple as taking care of your employees, whether you're taking care of your stakeholder, communication with various people, vendors, etc., right? So more importantly, they obviously now, there are, I think, two kinds of startups in for me, guys who raised money before COVID and guys who have not raised recently, right? So the plan changes accordingly. Somebody has the runway, they'll be able to really very differently approach the business, and guys who do not have a runway will be approaching the entire situation very differently. So in such scenarios, any kind of capital for them is going to be very important, right, to attract. So to extend runway, the most easiest thing for them right now is to cut costs, right, which the cost and unit economics and everything has been spoken about day in and day out. But after COVID, these things become, you know, your bread and butter, right? You cannot deviate from the basic business economics, right? We have to make sure the business model is robust. And if they are not, then those guys have a serious problem at hand, because now overnight they will have to figure out a way to find a way to attract investors and at the same time attract customers and be able to make it a plan where you can actually make it more interesting, right? So otherwise, people are not sitting with cash flow, they'll have a bigger problem.
Well, thank you for this introductory remark on this part. Coming back to you, Mr. Ritesh, that's it. I think the slowdown which you had basically posted is definitely going to be impacted in a big way. And I think what's even more disturbing is that there are number of exits which also have been stopped due to this coronavirus impact. And with respect to the buyout deals, also we are seeing a lot of deals being on hold. So what do you think, currently is the scenario on these two aspects? And also, if you can throw some light on what is the current pace of closures in this market with respect to the clients that you're dealing with?
So two things. One, the entire focus of the private equity community today is around handling their portfolio companies and seeing that there is no, that those portfolio companies are cash. Are cash positive and they survive. I think across more so in the venture capital stage and even in the private equity phase, in late stage phase, a lot of companies are going to need serious recapitalization. So the first and foremost focus of most of the funds right now is to look at handling their portfolio companies. The second phase comes in around when do we want to look at incremental capitalization, look at incremental deal closures, look at incremental exits, etc. Honestly, exits for the time being are not being talked about across the board. people are kind of just sitting back. There's been a huge reset, and there is going to be a huge reset on valuations. So exits are not going to be talked about in a hurry, whether it's a public issuance, whether it's a secondary exit, none of that is being talked about. What is being talked about across the private equity community is right now the need for recapitalizing the entire ecosystem. My suspicion is 50 to 60% of the large PE, of large companies will need a recapitalization. We've already seen some moves from Kotak, HDFC Life, etc., to raise more capital. As in when our sense is by end May, June, this is going to turn into a complete free for all, where everybody is looking at raising more money. So the focus right now for the private equity community is first and foremost on portfolios, and secondly on looking at these opportunities which are going to come their way in the next couple of months. Sorry, please go ahead.
Sure. So I think, rightly as you mentioned, that at least for the next couple of months, we're absolutely going to what I would say not witness those transactions. But do you think that once we are going out of this lockdown period, probably in a phased manner, when there is a huge chunk of customers sitting at one end who are in actual requirement of the money, do you think that the investor sentiments are also going to change that rapidly? Probably in a same quarter of month's time, or do you see that the closure of these deals will then be even delayed to further quarters of this financial year?
Yeah. So I'll tell you the challenge that most investors are facing today is the fact that while there are deals which are enough deals to do and transactions which will come through, the challenge is how do you price these transactions? I don't know whether the operations are suspended for 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, 1 year. I can't answer that question, and neither can the promoter, in all honesty. So in such a scenario, how do you price a transaction? Right? So the challenge is, if in public markets, it's fairly easy. The companies which are listed will have to dilute at the current prices. They have no option. In the private markets, the challenge is even more pronounced because, frankly, what price do you put? And if the price is too low, then the promoter always comes back and say, hey, listen, I'll wait out and see how things go along. So the challenge is actually the extent of disruption is so significant and so huge that one just doesn't know on how to price. So the biggest challenge for investors today is just figuring out how to price private deals.
Correct, sir. So I think the pricing is one such way where we can definitely take it as a key takeaway that how do you price the deals currently. So moving forward to Richard, that I think I've been just reading across that Unitas has been funding a lot of SMEs, that is one. But there have been several transactions with the MFIs and the NBFC space as well. So how do you think that since those industries are still what I would say in a phased operational stage, but do you think there are transactions which are happening in these mid-sized companies? And if yes, how do you think that these can be proceeded forward at least in this quarter?
Yeah, sure. So most of the work we do is in the financial services space. So across NBFCs, microfinance companies, specialized financial institutions, the transactions that were ongoing and had reached final stages have closed or will be closing shortly. So you'll see a few announcements. The ones that were still at a term sheet stage or diligence stage, quite frankly, those have paused for the most part. As investors are taking a pause to see how companies are reacting, what's going to come out of this crisis is the ones that will survive and the ones that won't. Cash and liquidity is certainly going to be extremely critical. So the runway that these companies have in terms of how long can they survive without before the next equity injection is very, very important and something that one has to wait out and see. Internal investors are you know, spending a lot of time and looking at these companies, their own portfolio companies, and assessing them. Everyone's doing, you know, BCPs. That's become the new word of the season. But the point is that everyone's trying to assess of what they can do to keep these companies going. And the ones that have enough runway of, I would say, 6-9 months are okay. The ones that have a runway of about 3 to 4 months are in more trouble if they don't have capital coming in through existing investors, because new deals have taken a hit and will take a hit. I think studies have already shown it'll be between 50 to 60% lower is what has already happened. And it's only going to come down. So for us to see significant capital injections into these sectors will take a while. But emerging out of this crisis are going to be the stronger companies, and those, when they do emerge, will need a lot of capital. So the dry powder that investors are sitting on, at some point they're going to have to come out and put that capital in work. But the types of companies they put it in and the price they put it in, one has to see.
Correct. So I think again, coming up with you know, another important issue is of the dry powder. How is that going to be utilized, and as well as you know, the pricing at which the deals can be valued. So I think in the next question, we'll certainly deliberate on this as well. Well, taking the discussion forward to Mr. Ankur, sir, since you know, we've seen that there's a downside in with respect to the PE and the VC investments, what is the scenario in this quarter with respect to the venture debt space? And you know, also, how do you would like to place this with respect to previous years? And probably in this quarter, what do you see that are the transactions which are still happening at you?
So I think venture debt that way is not very different from the PEVC environment, right? Because they generally are followers of the equity guys. So some of the venture debt guys may be more aggressive than the other folks, but generally overall environment currently is like that, that everybody would like to be cautious. It is, there's no point, you know, jumping the gun, trying to do a transaction, because you're not going to move anybody right by doing a transaction. You might be better, you be cautious and be on the side of that, because there's no point trying to do a transaction, because as my other panelists have suggested right now, nobody knows till what time the lockdown lasts, right? So because of that, it's very difficult for anybody to take a call on a new transaction. Existing transactions where you already have an exposure and where you know the company is already doing well, they have a decent amount of runway, you want to extend that runway, so there the venture debt obviously is a very good instrument to go, and that is some of the transactions that we are also evaluating at our end, because you already have an exposure with them, you have been seeing how they perform for the last 12-18 months, and you know the equity in the company, how is it going to attract, right? Or we know at least whether these are the kind of sectors who are going to have the good tailwind with them once the lockdown emerges out. So it is not anybody taking a new call right now is going to be very difficult, unless they're from some of those sectors or some companies which are already having raised a large kind of equity money, they're sitting with 12, 18 months of runway, then some of the situation may happen. But such deals will be very, very few compared to what the generally trend has been, right? Because the venture debt generally follows the equity cycle. So if equity is going to dry up, the debt will also definitely dry up, right? Even though they have the dry powder, they will might as well wait it out a quarter and see how things are panning out. So nobody would like to sort of forecast. It's very difficult to forecast what is going to really happen.
Absolutely. So I think we'll definitely come back to this point of, you know, the follow-up deals, how are they going to be impacted. Taking this discussion further, I think I'll come back to you, Mr. Ritesh, that, you know, although we've seen that, you know, you've given us an understanding that at least for a quarter or a couple of quarters is where we are, you know, there will be a slight, I would say, downside on with respect to the deals. But once this, you know, the operations resume, or at least we are in what I would say some percentage of the operationalness in the industry, there will be, you know, a very focused approach with respect to how the market is going to, you know, proceed in that note. So we will see a lot of specialized deals and structured finance deals. So how do you think that, you know, that is going to take up a role in this particular scenario, and which sectors do you think, you know, can be a part of the first round of the deal closures with respect to your clientele?
So let me answer the second part of the question first. I think the first and foremost is we are going to see significant deal activity in financial services. Every financial services company will have a problem of assets, of NPAs, and the scale of the problem will vary from one institute to the other. So financial services is one area where we believe significant fundraising is going to happen. The other area that we believe that healthcare is going to see a lot of investment coming through, especially on diagnostic labs, etc., because you know, surprisingly, there are only three or four national chains in the country of our size, which is quite surprising. So there are sectors which are interesting, but to these two sectors kind of stand out. Now, in terms of the overall market, I see, you know, just addressing that, there are sectors which will take a serious hit. I mean, you know, some obvious sectors are known to everybody, aviation, travel, etc., hospitality, etc., are obviously going to take a hit. My thesis is that consumer discretionary will take a significant hit. Right, anything to do with extra spending or which is not essential spending, as I would call it, is going to take a hit. So, you know, stuff like apparel will be down. Stuff like anything related to leisure will be down. So all those sectors will face a serious challenge going forward, simply because of the fact that across the board, there has been a massive income destruction, income impairment which has happened. There's been massive wealth destruction, and there is going to be a significant amount of job losses coming out of this, whether we like it or not. So the reality of the situation is that the broader economy is going to be in a real, real pain point. You've got to identify, I mean, in our view, financial services will be the one sector that will need immediate money. And thereafter, you'd look at, you know, sectors like healthcare, etc.
Certainly, sir. Thank you for that input. So, Richard, taking this question forward to you, you know, how would you like to place your operations with respect to, you know, the opening up of the market and once it resumes the operations? So, which sectors do you think that, you know, Unitest will definitely be looking at, or, you know, as an industry, what do you think that your ticket size of deals? So, where is that going to happen?
Yeah, you know, we're still very bullish on financial services in the long run. And financial services for us broadly includes even fintech, SME lending, ag finance, education finance, so all of the specialized lenders as well. While in the short term, many might struggle and many might go under, I think, as I said, the better companies will emerge and those will need a lot of capital. So we expect to see a flurry of deals happen once folks are beginning to come out of this. We've also already started seeing investor interest from investors that are open to doing distressed transactions, investors that have a slightly longer term view on the market in terms of looking at it more from 7 to 10 year horizons rather than the typical 5 to 7 year horizons. Those guys are still very much looking at this. The ones that can hold on in private companies and also hold on till they take it public, so they're not in as much of a pressure. On the healthcare side, we definitely see a lot more activity. In fact, just yesterday, I was speaking with an investor, a very large foundation globally that has about $500 million allocated towards healthcare to fight the COVID pandemic, right? And there are many such foundations and impact investors and initiatives that have come up in order to support healthcare and any such services that revolve around the pandemic, be it diagnostics, be it pharma, you know, be it services. And so coming out of this, I think we're going to see significant investments in that sector as well. Consumers are definitely going to take a hit. Anything consumer related, if it's not essential, will. And we don't expect to see as much activity there. EdTech and ag are two areas where we continue to see activity. There've been a lot of players in the EdTech space in the last, let's say, 24 months that have come up. And they're all continuously innovating and coming up with models that are relevant for today's scenario. So, and there has been a lot of funding going into that. And we expect to see more of that coming in as well.
Okay. So, you know, with I think you've added EdTech to your comments over here. So, do you think that this sector, you know, probably in this pandemic situation also, still, you know, will be able to do a little bit better with respect to, you know, other sectors of the similar space?
I think better is relative in today's context. I do think that there are models that are emerging and consumer adaptation to those models are improving. Right. So what I would not have used 2 months ago, I will use today. And if I'm able to make that habitual, there's a good chance of the company surviving in the long term. Right. So in terms of actual relevance, it's extremely relevant in today's time and will stay so, I think, for a while. Because as you would have read, many institutions in India and abroad have deferred opening times. Right. So I think there's going to be a need for these products, at least in the short term and certainly in the long term as well.
Okay, thank you. Well, coming back to you, Mr. Ankur, do you think that, you know, any sectors apart from this in respect to the startup space, you would be looking at, you know, once this situation eases up a little bit, or you have the similar viewpoint with respect to maritime Ritesh on this part?
So, I agreed with Richa and Ritesh, whatever they mentioned. Just to add to that, I think companies like B2B, who have been on the B2B e-commerce side, companies who have helped the sector go from an analog to digital, that is going to be the theme, right? Because India is very fragmented, and the value of technology adoption is going to change significantly. A lot of the SMEs also now going to be forced to use technology because they would need demand, and these platforms are able to aggregate such demand on their on themselves and attract the SMEs also. So because supply anyway is going to be disrupted significantly. And if these platforms are going to get a good kind of supply, the demand to them is anyway is going to be increasing very large. So for me, B2B is going to be a very interesting phenomenon once obviously the lockdown opens up. Another sector that I believe is going to do well is logistics. I feel that is a sector which has to pick up significantly, because without that, the country is already feel stifled. Despite so many trucks being stuck, we still had some essential services being distributed. But I believe once non-essential also gets into the e-commerce bandwagon, the logistic as a whole is going to really grow significantly. But I believe that any of those aggregators who are working on the that side as well, not just the brick and mortar logistic companies, but also the aggregators on the logistic side, the tech-enabled companies, they are going to feel a lot of growth. We have seen in our own portfolio companies, sitting within like 2 weeks or 3 weeks sitting, they are able to attract business, right? And large companies are coming to them because they cannot go to a brick and mortar or a mom and pop shop for doing distribution right now. They want somebody who can also take care of their stakeholders, right? Because you do not just want the business to happen. You want to ensure that you're working with partners who are also going to ensure the new realities are being followed on ground. So they want this kind of partner. Startups that way are very quick to be able to adopt and bring in the changes that are required in the business processes, so that things like social distancing are able to actually be incorporated in their day-to-day activities and processes.
Correct. Well, fair enough on that part, sir. And I think just to take your previous comment, which you mentioned on the follow-up deals. So I think now that we have got an idea of the sectors which, you know, probably are going to emerge once the lockdown and this situation eases up, I think I'd like to hear a comment from you on, you know, a comparison between the follow-up deal versus the new customers in those sectors. So which do you think, you know, and how is the deal making going to happen between the follow-up existing customers versus the new customers?
So new customer, as my other panelists have also mentioned, new deal happening right now will take some time, right? So
once the situation eases up, I mean, once we are into a, let's say, a new normal phase, do you think?
So I think people always go to their existing investors first, because you know you know yourself whether the investor has the appetite for further rounds or not, right? So generally this period is being used for bridge rounds, for doing this short follow-up rounds. Some of them have some extended rounds also, where you can attract a new investor. Now the new investor depends, you know, it depends on a lot of things. That new investor could be a lead investor they're waiting for, or it could be a situation where the new investor is just another small add-on to the entire equity round. So new investor, obviously, if you're able to get at even the old valuation, it's great. Otherwise, it's very difficult to expect right now to happen, because everybody's quite cautious. But follow-up round is going to be easiest route if somebody has available, and they would already be in talks with all their investors, right? Whether even if you have a 12-month runway, that conversation would be happening at the board level, that whether I should be able to, at what time I can come back to you, right? And there would be some milestones that the company has to be able to achieve, or some kind of activity the business has to come back to for them to be able to get that kind of funding. So follow-on and new, I believe, can happen together. It's not just one of the two, it could be both as well.
Fair enough, sir. Mr. Ritesh, taking this question down to you, sir, that with respect to the follow-up versus you know, the new customers approaching for the deals, so what are your thoughts on this particular question?
No, I think I completely agree with Ankur. I think right now the whole focus of existing investors is to see that portfolio companies, as I said, at the outset, are well capitalized and they have the capital. So the first focus is going to be on those businesses. And I think deal making will start only, my sense is probably the end of this quarter, early next quarter, only people will start looking at sectors and companies very selectively.
Sure, sir. Richa, your comments on this particular part with respect to the follow-up versus the new deals?
Yeah, I think same thing. Very few new deals, like I said, will happen except for folks that are looking at long-term bets or distressed deals. And people are going to wait and watch, because what you want to also wait for, besides deciding what the right price is really what the new normal is, right? Right. And for each industry, there's a different metric that you look at. So what's the new normal of that metric? In financial services, what's the new normal of your delinquencies? If you were at 1-2% before, it's not 1-2% anymore going forward. What is that number going to be, and how do I price that in? So there are lots of moving pieces, and it's anybody's guess when things will open up and start reverting towards that new normal. So deals will certainly take time. So we'll see more existing investor deals coming in to help out portfolio companies, but new deals will be fewer in number for sure.
Sure. Taking this conversation further with you only, so with respect to what I would say the handholding to, which is required in the coming times. So do you think, that there's going to be an evolved stage of an investment banking process? And if yes, how do you think that, it's going to change for you as a team?
Yeah, I think good question. We're figuring that out ourselves internally right now. One of the things we've realized is it's important to have a year closer to the ground and being close to your client, not just in good times, but in bad as well, right? And for us to be able to, one, understand what's happening on the ground, not just from a single company perspective, but from an industry perspective is useful. So being able to share that knowledge and insights that we're able to gather from the ground just purely because of relationships that we have to help companies, I think that's been one. The second is providing the right advice. I think a lot of bankers we've seen have actually jumped up and said, look, we have one investor and we're going to bring capital into you. I frankly find that very suspect. Just to get a transaction, please don't overpromise. That's one thing we always say. I think it's better to give realistic advice. And if the realistic advice means you're not going to get capital now, that's the right advice to give. So just being true to your clients in all ways in terms of what is or is not possible, I think is what works. But we're seeing more hand-holding required by clients because everyone's trying to figure out what to do, when is the right time to raise capital, who are the right investors to go after. So just more in an advisory capacity than before.
When taking this question to you, Mr. Ankur, that how do you think that the internal processes involved in the deal making are going to evolve internally within your organization, and how do you plan to go about the change?
Internal processes for deal making, I don't see very much changing. The biggest impact is going to be, as Richa mentioned, the new normal. So one needs to understand how this business is going to function and how it is the entire model is going to change, right? Because it's just not as what Excel MIS showed 6 months back can be just projected for the next 6 months, because that entire gap in between what the company did during that time and what are their customers doing that time, whether there is a need for that company, whether there's a need for that business model or not, that is going to be only explained once the lockdown sort of starts opening up and whether the customers are interested in it. So like, for example, we are against consumer companies, but there could be some models within it who might be actually interesting, right? Because they're doing, for example, they might be in sanitation space. They might also may get a lot of demand for it. So one can't just rule out a sector as such. One has to see the company within it, what are the models around it. Some of them might be bringing certain very different niche for the customer, which sort of may actually do better. So whatever we used to study a company with, now because of the COVID, the new normal one is to understand how this business is going to function, whether it is going to make sense or not. Because for example, an OTT company, now maybe 6 months back, people may think it's a very difficult business to evaluate, but the way it has changed the last couple of months, with Netflix having the highest number of subscriptions happening in the last month, so maybe you look at it very differently. Similarly for health tech, similarly for ed tech. So some of these companies are not going to change. Just because COVID goes away does not mean that interest in those platforms are going to go away, because parents suddenly realize, okay, ed tech makes sense, right? Schools suddenly realize that ed tech also makes sense because they're able to conduct classrooms. And they'll be able to use it within their own regular business also. But if you're not able to involve it in the new normal, which is that when the schools open up at one point of time and that platform is no longer used, then obviously that model is of not much use. So one has to see, obviously go in a bit more detail to see the various dynamics, situation, how it is evolving. And it's very difficult to sort of just pinpoint, okay, it is going to be A or B. It could be C, and one has to apply your mind whether that is going to happen.
Correct. Well, thank you. Mr. Ritesh, coming to you on this particular part, sir, that how do you think that this new normal process is going to evolve internally, within your team, and how do you plan to prepare for this on that part, sir?
So candidly, we are just still trying to get a grapple arms with what is the new normal. I don't think any of us have the answer to it at this point in time. And when I speak to companies and promoters, I think the consistent messaging is that people are just clueless, and people are very candidly clueless about the fact that, with things going to get back to normal, and what is a new normal? What is for certain is two things. One is that certain business models are going to be relooked at with a microscope. Again, stuff which we used to take as commonplace are going to be looked at with the microscope, number one. Number two, as one of the panelists or one of the participants has also asked, there is going to be a complete reset of valuations from what we've seen in the past. India historically has been a very richly valued market simply because of the fact that there are it's always price growth here. Now, if growth doesn't happen, and growth doesn't happen for the foreseeable future, what do you pay money for? What do you pay a premium for? And that's the significant shift that you will see going forward, that, across the board. And I'm keeping public markets out of it, because public markets actually don't necessarily reflect the true economic, what's happening in the economy completely, because public markets are largely driven by liquidity as well. And there's a surfeit of liquidity around the world. But private market valuations will certainly see a reset. My suspicion is so will public markets. Once the liquidity, steroid kind of dries up over a period of time, so will public markets. Even before the crisis happened, the divergence between the public and private markets was the highest that it's ever been in terms of valuations. My sense is that will continue for a while, but over a period of time, we will certainly see valuations being reset.
Right, we have a lot of questions to address after this. So just a quick last question to the panel on this part is that, since you guys keep interacting with what I would say all the investors in your portfolio companies, as well as new clients in the industry. So with respect to a short-term versus a long-term strategy, which a company can adopt to today, because everybody is agreeing to this fact that, there has to be a fundamental, change with respect to the strengthening of the due diligence processes which are going to happen for the deals to come. And in fact, the way the companies are being evaluated for this lockdown period, as mentioned by Mr. Ranko, that what have they done for these 5 to 6 months is certainly going to be very crucial. So, what is your quick take on one? What are the investors looking at versus a short-term and a long-term? And also, any advice which you have for a corporate or a mid-size and the startup firm? I think if three of you can address, we can start with each on this one.
Sure. So I think companies in general should build for the long term but adjust for the short term. So unless you're building a company that is really meant to last the cycles and the waves, you're not going to get investor interest, because everyone looks at it to see if you can adjust and move through these cycles. Now, this is obviously an extremely unprecedented one, which no one was expecting to happen, either in terms of the amount or the impact that it's really going to have on the economy in general. But if you're building a business for the long term, keeping the basics in mind, but you're able to be agile enough to adjust your business model for the short term, you'll still have investor interest, I think. And if you demonstrate that for investors, you'll see people coming in.
Thank you for that advice. Mr. Ranku, your comments on this part?
So I think long-term India story, all of us will agree, is not going anywhere. So as long as you are in a business model which is having good customers, you have good margins, you are always able to grow at a consistent pace. And if you are able to attract customers, not spending the crazy amount of marketing dollars, I think those businesses are not going to go out of fashion. You may start attracting that customer, your investor maybe later on, but till then, how quickly you're able to use this period. What did you do during this period? Were you able to attract a new kind of customers? Were you able to solve some other new kind of customer problem during this period? Were you able to reduce your vendor's cost, right? Whether you, as a founder, did you reduce your own salary, right? What did you do during, did you pay the rent or not? So some of the short-term things are going to show how the founder is going to plan, how is he planned during this kind of situation, right? Because during adverse situations only you come to know the real mettle of any company or a management team, right? And how did the investors behave during that period of time? So whatever we do during this time, though, we may have the excuse of COVID, but finally, we are all in the same boat, right? It's not that COVID is different for different people. Obviously, in certain sectors, it is impacted in a larger way than a smaller way. But if you are able to create something out of it, right? If you're going to create a new business model out of it or a new niche for yourself, that is going to really attract investors, because that means you're able to use that adverse situation, that challenge, and convert into an opportunity for yourself. And that is what I think every investor is looking for. Finally, it is a call on the founder, right? Finally, it's a call on the business model. So if during this period also you were able to show something which was very unique, that is going to be great, right? Obviously, survival, I think, right now is the most important thing. That's why we are talking about liquidity and everything. But finally, if something was delivered to somebody and you're ready to pay a price for it, that is going to really stand out. And finally, investors will definitely look for something, as long as it's not a niche thing and not like exactly a Me Too kind of product.
Mr. Ritesh, your comments on this particular part, sir, a short-term and a long-term view for your customers, as well as keeping in mind the sentiments of the investors you have impacted.
So I think in the short term, the only advice that we are giving our clients is across the board is that please be very, very cash conscious in terms of how you're looking at it. If any of you have existing lines of credit that you unutilize, draw them down now. Be liquid. It doesn't matter if you run a negative carry on the liquidity, but be cash positive, because there are going to be significant disruptions in the way in business itself, right? Some of the portfolio companies, I'll give you our example, that we have one of our portfolio companies is reopened operations, but they are unable to get any raw material because all the raw material suppliers are either operating at 10% capacity, or even if they have inventory lying, they are unable to ship it to the factory. So we are in a situation wherein multiple things will go wrong, including the entire supply chain has been completely disrupted as part of this process. And unfortunately, it's not going to come back in a hurry. It will take some time to get back to what I would call a level of normalcy. So in the short run, maintain cash. In the long run, evaluate your business model very, very carefully. It has to be predicated on actual customer value being generated. I think the days of frothy valuations, days of going with a business plan and raising lots of money, etc., are gone for some time to come.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for this comment. So I think we've got a huge list of questions to address to you, but just to summarize this panel discussion, although we could have continued for a few more minutes, but it's a time constraint, we'll have to take a part on this way. So we've had a good discussion from this part where we have kind of summarized that yes, at least for a couple of quarters for now, the slowdown is definitely going to impact all strata of business. We have heard it from the large corporate deal makers to mid-size towards the companies who are funding startups. And also, I think a very good advice which we have got for the companies from that note is that, please sit tight on your cash currently in the short term, versus you have to, be very, very cautious with respect to your business models coming up in the near future to come. So with this, we've got another list of sectors also which are going to be, evolving in the new normal. But again, the definition of the new normal is yet to be clarified. But yes, we've got a gist of ideas with respect to the sectors which are probably, likely to come up from that point. Taking this discussion further to the Q&A, I would request all panelists, if I can just, run on the Q&A questions, and if anybody of you to take up that question, you're most welcome to take it. We can start with one-on-one questions. So we have close to 11 questions posted in the Q&A space. There are some questions which are posted in the chat section as well. And to attendees also, if you have any other questions, you can post in the Q&A section. We'll try to address as many as questions possible in this particular session. Post that, if there are any questions unanswered, we'll definitely circulate these questions to the panelists, and we'll get back to you over an email with the answers for them. So I'm just, going to start off with the first question. So we have a question that in order to diversify the supply chain base, in the view of the world hostility towards China for COVID-19, large number of companies are expected to shift based from China to other Southeast Asian countries. How does the VC community can help in Indian entrepreneurs in this regard? We have someone from the panel to take this question.
So let me take that. I think the challenge today is that entrepreneurs are not ready to invest, and they haven't been even before COVID. So if you see actual data, our investment, private investment by Indians has actually been falling year on year, right? Reality is if somebody is setting up greenfield capacity or brownfield capacity to diversify either supply chains or expand capacity, etc., I think most funds will be very supportive. It's just our challenge has been that I don't think generally investors, entrepreneurs are actually taking that bet today. So somebody needs to step up and start doing that. And if I think by and large, investors will be quite supportive of such a move.
I would just like to add to that. I think the government needs to play a big role in that. They need to be able to incentivize the entrepreneur to be able to take risk. I think right now the government policies also as such, setting up a plant or setting up any kind of new thing requires the amount of supply chain effort required. It's very difficult. So I think the Make in India has still not taken off the way it's supposed to. So I think now is a great opportunity for the government to actually start doing something about it.
Sure. Taking on the next question, so is that private equity for real estate sector on entity platform deals on project specific basis, any idea? What can be the sources, domestic or foreign return expectations?
So I can add to the real estate part since we also have a real estate arm. On real estate, we believe that sector is going to be really impacted in a big way because they were already under a lot of struggle. For the branded developer right now, he's also going to look at his own situation then take up new project. So any new project taking up, because the only way for the grade B, grade C developer to exit was to tie up with a grade A developer. Now grade A developer himself will be under his own kind of stress. So any real estate, new transaction, new project launches, any kind of divestment activities for them is going to be very tough. So this is only going to get further delayed, much more than anything else, because buying a house is not going to be anybody's top priority. So that is going to be the last priority for any customer, at least for the next 6 months, as we can at least foresee. So for them, real estate will take the longest time to, I think, bounce back.
Sure. Moving on to next, so apart from real estate, hospitality and travel, which sectors will face hardships to raise further rounds? I think although we have a list of sectors which are going to do slightly better than others, but still we can have any heads up on this particular part.
I think anything that's non-essential is going to be difficult. So anything on the consumer side that doesn't come in the non-essentials category is going to struggle for a while. Even business models that are typically run brick and mortar are going to struggle unless they find tech-enabled interventions to it.
Sure.
I would just like to add, even financial services, the fintech companies and even the NBFCs, the smaller NBFCs will struggle, at least for the time being, because the asset quality for some of these guys is going to be easy for them to attract capital. The larger names obviously will be able to do, but within fintech also, I will feel that there will be a lot of damage which will be done because the way salary cuts are happening, layoffs are happening, the delinquency are going to increase. So for them, further raise of capital, equity or debt is going to be challenging.
Yeah, I agree with Ankur. I think there's going to be a lot of casualties in the financial services space in general, especially the ones that are undercapitalized.
Well, to take it forward, kindly share your views on impact on investment in infrastructure sector, power, roads in specific. If anybody can take this up.
I'm not an expert on the infrastructure sector, but you know, honestly, very little private investment was going into that sector, say for a few groups, with the exception of the Adanis, etc., for example. Our sense is that it's only, and data shows that it was largely the government expenditure which was fueling the economy and part of the economy, especially in sectors like roads, was delivering results. my our sense again, and this is just a hunch, is that that expenditure will get crowded out because the focus will go to basic humanitarian assistance first, and then and stuff like healthcare and food before allocating resources to the infrastructure sector. So I certainly see government spending coming down in those sectors as well.
Okay, thank you for taking it up. Okay. So the next thing that the panel has two questions. So we understand that new deals will be on hold for a quarter or more. Can you please advise what measures can be taken to care to be specifically taken so that all things are normalized? I think the panelists have already taken that up. The products of NBFCs which are more attracting or will be more attracting in the future. From an NBFC perspective, there's a question with respect to the product.
Yeah, I'm happy to take a stab at that. I think the products that will be more attractive from an NBFC perspective are going to be ones that are more business loan related rather than consumer lending. Consumer lending is certainly going to take a hit. So any loans that were given for things like white good purchases, those are going to take a hit. Any personal loans are going to take a hit. But working capital is probably going to do better. And that also, there's still going to be stricter underwriting norms. So today, loans might be given out left, right, and center by a number of players. Underwriting has become tighter and is going to continue to become tighter on that front as well.
Sure.
I just would like to add that SME unsecured portion is going to also take a huge hit. So that SMEs, unsecured business is not going to do well going forward. So the entire focus is going to go towards more secured business. That's our internal belief.
Correct. So next we have a question is that how is the market looking like in gaming platform, real money especially? Take on the gaming platform from the panel. We've seen a lot of, engagement on the gaming platform these days in the lockdown phase.
So I think gaming is within betting and there is gaming, there's a lot of gray area within the way the country structure is, right? The regulations are not very pro that. So, but it's called a game of skill. It may not be called a game of skill. So a lot of investors have typically tried to remain away from it, right? And some games do well and some games do not do well. So it's a sector which has been very mixed in terms of the investor experience with them. So even we have generally stayed away from that. But of course, because of digital space and because of entertainment, that sector obviously has seen a huge amount of traction. But in terms of companies which are there, which are actually running large, there are only a couple of them. There are not many which are actually become very large in that space. So there's an opportunity, definitely. Esports has become another opportunity for people to look at. And there have been some investments, early stage investments in that space. But I think it's still an opportunity which is much more untapped than where we are, right? It's not like e-commerce where there are already multiple players in various verticals. Gaming, I believe, still has a relatively long way to go. That's our personal view.
Sure. Next is for investors, what are the areas of interest in terms of investment as far as the startup pitch deck is concerned? Although we've had comments on the strategies, so if anybody would like to take this up. We can proceed towards the next question from that one. I think we've covered this. Most of the questions are basically related to the sectors on that note. So we have a question for you, Mr. Ritesh, that certain businesses will be looked at a microscope level. Can you illustrate some of these sectors?
For example, as I was mentioning, anything consumer discretionary, for example, is a big question mark right now. Will consumers go out and spend? I mean, I cited the example of apparel, for example. Will consumers go out and spend money on buying something which is non-essential? Will they pay extra premium for products? We are entering into a period wherein consumers are likely to downgrade rather than to upgrade. So, there are across the board, you will see that honestly on white and brown goods, impact is also going to be there. People are going to defer purchases of electronic items, etc., unless there's a replacement demand. So, you know, one, and again, look at, let me put it differently, like take an example of coming back to apparel or something like that. When is the next time you're going to go to a mall? When is the next time you are going to, if you're not going to go to a mall, how do you drive traffic? How do you get people into your stores? And even high street, you know, how many people are going to walk into a store in a, and how many people will be willing to spend in a hurry? So those are questions. I mean, we looked at this, we looked at a restaurant transaction, and you know, the same question we were debating with the promoter of the business, that, you know, are we shut for 3 months, 6 months, 9 months? When is the next time that somebody will go out and eat in a restaurant? So, you know, those are questions. Now, there are fixed costs associated with every business. How long do you think that such a dislocation can last? Unfortunately, none of us have an answer. So, you know, when you're preparing for, when you're looking at a business plan for something, you've got to prepare for the worst and say, assuming nothing happens for 1 year. How much cash am I going to burn? What is my fixed cost, etc.? And then even then, sales, it's not that one fine day, the switch is going to turn on 1st of April 2021, so the switch is going to turn on, people are going to start walking in. As in, when sales start picking up, they'll be gradual, right? It's not going to be a V-shaped recovery as people keep talking about. So, you know, those are questions that when I say people have to look at very fundamentally, what is the cost structure like? How do you ensure that you survive for 12 months or 6 months or 9 months, whatever be that period be? So that's what I meant, that people will be looking at businesses and business models per se very, very closely.
Sure. So I think we have, the questions have been piling up from that note in the Q&A section. But let us just take a quick last question, and after this we can just, you know, and basically take a list of all these questions and we can get back to you for the answers, and then we can share it with the attendees of this webinar. The last question is that, you know, will there be a change in expected returns post-COVID? That's a very obvious question, but yes, if any specific sector-wise, you know, you'd like to take up that question.
So let me give you my thoughts. I think generally India needs to get, needs to adjust itself to lower rates. Typically, any return on equity is just typically a premium on the risk-free rate. Now, if your risk-free rate is falling continuously, today you are at 6.6 quarter, your premium on risk that you would take for equity will be on the risk-free rate. And as we are moving to a lower interest rate regime, the reality of the situation is return expectations from equity will also come down.
Okay.
So one has to be prepared. Now, what is that right number? I don't know. But I think people need to be more expect, you know, it's great if people can make 25 odd percent returns, but you know, those are going to be far and few in between.
Sure, sir. Thank you for taking up that last question. Well, with this, you know, I'd like to thank all the panelists for being a part of this webinar today. We had very insightful discussions, you know, on the topic. Although we've been able to touch, you know, very basics of the things, but yes, with respect to a layman who is you know, looking for some answers in this particular space, I think we have addressed questions on the sector part, the business models part, as well as, you know, what are the investment sentiments looking at. So once again, thank you so much to all three of you for, you know, taking out time and joining in here today. For the list of the questions, we'll definitely get back to you, and, you know, we'll be sharing this with the attendees from that.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thank you all the attendees for taking this up. Till then, stay safe, stay indoors. Have a good evening, guys.